So this is a classic picture for holoprosencephaly, specifically a subtype, alobar holoprosencephaly, the most severe type. So unless you're doing a lot of pediatric radiology, there's a good chance that you won't see this type of case in your day-to-day life. Most of the patient with severe form of holoprosencephaly or alobar holoprosencephaly either born stillbirth or they don't survive long after. But nonetheless, this is a classic picture of alobar holoprosencephaly, so I think it's a fair to ask you on a board exam, I think. So let's look at some of the features that make holoprosencephaly the best choice here. Well, first of all, even though the picture looks quite strange if you haven't seen a lot of this type of case, hopefully you notice that there's absence of septum pellucidum. Remember, on board exam and in real life, if I see absence of septum pellucidum, things I should be thinking about would be holoprosencephaly or septo-optic dysplasia, among other midline anomaly stuff. And also note that there are absence of other midline structures, such as not just septum pellucidum, but corpus callosum. Also, you see there's no fox or interhems fissure, and there's a fusion of the brain. So left side and right side of the brain is not divided. And you also see this large monoventricle. So again, the division is not complete between the left and right side, the lateral ventricle or the third ventricle. The reason that this ventricle look a little bit bizarre is that often you have associated dorsum cyst. So the ventricle looks rather oddly shaped, but this is a classic picture for alobar holoprosencephaly monoventricle. And another classic feature you will see is this so-called fused pancake brain. Remember, the division of the brain start from posterior to anterior. So that's an important pattern to keep in mind. Now, if you look at the type of holoprosencephaly in terms of severity, from most severe alobar to semilobar to the mildest form, which is lobar. In our case, we have an alobar holoprosencephaly, complete lack of division between left and right side of hemisphere. As the case become more mild, you can see that there's division begin from posterior to anterior. So therefore, you have a beginning formation of the posterior part of the lateral ventricle. And also notice that you have a start division of a basal ganglia, and there's a fusion of the thalami, but you can see the posterior part of the third ventricle start to form. In the most mildest form of holoprosencephaly, you can see that the division of posteriorly is basically formed, so left and right side looks completely separated with interhems fissure. Anteriorly, there's still some fusion. Remember, again, the pattern division is from posterior to anterior, superior to inferior. So therefore, the last place that will be divided would be the anterior inferior aspect of the frontal lobe. The common denominator, again, is absence of the septum pellucidum. Also of interest that you can use the development of corpus callosum to assess the severity of holoprosencephaly. So in the most severe form, in our case, alobar holoprosencephaly, you see there's complete absence of the corpus callosum. In this case of semilobar, you can see beginning formation of the posterior part of the corpus callosum, but you're missing a large chunk of the anterior part, including genu and the rostrum. And as the case become more and more mild, you can see that the posterior part of the corpus callosum is formed pretty well. You can see a nice splenium here in the posterior body of corpus callosum, but the anterior part remain fused. So that's another way to assess the severity of the holoprosencephaly. What about other answers that does not work as well in this case? Well, first of all, agenesis of corpus callosum. While it's true that you do not see any corpus callosum, but certainly this is not a picture of classic agenesis of corpus callosum. The better choice here is going to be holoprosencephaly. All the midline structure is absent. For open lift schizencephaly, you see this large open cliff. But as you see, schizencephaly is a CSF cliff that extends from peripheral of the brain, extending into the ventricle. The hallmark is that the cliff is lined by gray matter, often dysplastic gray matter. So that's one way to differentiate that entity from prosencephalic cyst. And in this case, this is an example of septo-optic dysplasia with schizencephaly. Again, you see absence of the septum pellucidum, and when I see that, I think about holoprosencephaly. I'm thinking about septo-optic dysplasia on board exam. And in this case, some people will consider septo-optic dysplasia as the mildest form of holoprosencephaly. But the division of left and right side brain is complete, unlike holoprosencephaly. For aqueductal stenosis, the enlargement of the ventricle here is not due to obstruction, so this is not obstructive hydrocephalus. So aqueductal stenosis with hydrocephalus is also not the correct answer in this case. Good luck on your board exam. Thanks for your attention.